sin that held him back until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me back. I know that it is finished.
Morning, welcome to Bethel Baptist Church this morning. Would you stand and let's sing Standing on the Promises of Christ My King. Standing on the Promises. Standing on the promises of Christ My King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises.
Hey, good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a beautiful cold spring morning God gave us to be able to come to church this morning. And I tell you, it is a beautiful day, but we have beautiful people here to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with. And as you've come in today, you probably got your bulletin, but also if you did not get one of these, they're available after the church service. There's going to be an evangelism conference for our association held at Clearview Baptist Church a week from Friday and Saturday. That's going to be the March 31st and April 1st. And if you're interested in going, love for you to be able to go. We just need to register you for it. And so if you would, just take time to tear off this little tab down here. You can drop that in the offering bucket as you're going out this morning. If you're watching us online and we're not able to be here in person, if you'll call the church office, we'll be glad to register you for you. And if you aren't going to go or anything, if you would, just leave this on the pew. We'll pick it up, recycle it, and reuse it again next week. But what a joy it is to see you all here today. And I just want to say thank you so much for being here. Your presence matters. Truly it does. Be able to see your smiling faces, be able to hug your necks and shake your hands. We're family, and in family is where we're able to gain encouragement and love one for another as we love God. And so we want to say welcome once again, but let's put our minds and thoughts on Psalms 9. Read with me. I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell you of all the marvelous things you have done. I will be filled with joy because of you. I will sing praises to your name, O Most High. And I tell you, he says, I'll praise you, Lord, with all my heart. Let this day be the day that we truly praise him with all of our heart, not just part of our heart. Let's remain standing for the invocation this morning as Brother Harry comes and leads us.
Let us pray. Father God, as we come in your presence this morning, we hear for one reason and one reason only, to worship you and praise your name. All other thoughts should be stripped from my mind, except to offer praises to you in song and in the hearing of your word preached. And Lord, keep this ever muttering on my mind. Regardless of what the shape the world's in, we have you looking after us, and we must always remember that. May everything that we do and say during this hour and during our lives be only to praise you and worship you. I ask this in the name of God and Jesus, the one who gave us a saving power that we can rely on. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. Filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. Walking in sunlight all of my journey. Heavenly sunlight.
Walking in sunlight all of my journey, over the mountains, through the deep vale. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee. Promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Hallelujah, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. Shadows around me, shadows above me, never conceal my Savior and guide. He is the light, in him is no darkness. Ever I'm walking close to his side. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul. Praises, Jesus is mine.
In the bright sunlight, ever rejoicing, pressing my way to mansions above, singing his praises, gladly I'm walking, walking in sunlight, sunlight of love. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul with glory divine. Alleluia, I am rejoicing, singing his praises, Jesus is mine. Amen. You may be seated.
We started this morning with talking about how that I will praise the Lord with all of our heart. So I want to hear some of your praises. What have you got on your heart that you want to praise the Lord for? I want to hear from you. Share. Health.
Yeah.
Especially, but you know, sometimes you don't know how to appreciate health until you've been sick, right? Yeah. What else? Grace. Oh, God's wonderful, matchless grace. Yes, without it, we wouldn't none be here. What else are you thankful for? Family. Yeah. Family, they can aggravate you and they can bless you, can't they? Yeah, boy. What else are you thankful for? Who? What? I can't hear you. Light? Life. Okay, life. Yes. You know, just the blessing of just knowing that we're going through this life, we're able to experience him, and we're here with him, and he's with us. What else you want to praise him for this morning? Jesus is mine. So thankful for that. What? So I heard somebody over here. What's that? For your preacher. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate it. Oh, yeah. What else you want to praise him for today? Are you church? Yeah. Church is more than a building. Church is family. Church is worship. Church is missions and ministry. Presence? Friends. Friends, yes. We need friends, do we not? And oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. Yeah. His faithfulness, yes. You know, we might not understand true faithfulness because the only thing we've ever known is people to be unfaithful to us from time to time, but God's faithfulness never wavers. What else you want to thank him for today? Say it one more time. Eternity in heaven. Wow. Yeah, we're just here for a little while. Better make your reservations here. Yep. What else? Heat. Did you say heat? Somebody say heat. I still can't hear. Heat, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, there's people that don't have the privilege of being able to adjust a thermostat to get warm or have warmer clothes to be able to put on and things like that. What else? His Word. Yeah. That's what I want to focus on is always God's Word, because in His Word, we discover who God is. We also discover who we are in Him, and we also discover about our fellow man. Yeah, His Word, precious Word. What else? Water. Yeah, somebody. Yeah, thank the Lord for. You know, I mean, this is why we do this sometimes. Make you think about something other that maybe you haven't always thought about. Water.
Choice.
You need it. You know, when you think about water, we can't live without it. And, you know, we need it to drink. We need it to bathe. We need it to flush our toilets. Think about it. I mean, you know, just think about it. You know, you need, yeah, thank you very much. You know, I mean, right, Steve? I mean, we need water all the time, do we not? You know? So I'm going to knock him out after church. What else?
Choice.
Toys?
Choice.
Choice.
Choice. All right, yeah, choices in which we have. You know, for one thing, we don't live in a dictatorship where we get to choose occupations and places to go and who we want to become. And God also gives us a choice as well to love him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength and body. If we choose not to, then just expect the repercussions to happen. I heard food over here. Yeah, I like food too. Everybody here, I think, likes food. Yeah, I thank the Lord for those chickens that gave it up so that I could eat it often. Pigs and cows and lambs and fishies. And I eat everything. What else? Finishing school. Harry, that should have been your praise report. Yes, yes. Patty finally got that college degree last week, and we're proud of her and finishing up and getting her bachelor's. Way to go, girl. We're proud of you. What else? What don't you just want to praise him for today? Worship music. Oh, yeah. Truly a blessing from God, you know, helps us to be able to have our hearts stirred and puts things in our minds to be able to focus on him. Yeah, music. What else? What's that? Light? Yeah. And beds? Yeah. Yeah. For a lot of people, that's their favorite places, you know, is in bed, and that's why they're not at church. They're still hanging out in their favorite place. Yeah. Yeah. What else? Yes, ma'am. Faith to believe. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. You know, there's an old saying that says, what if you only get tomorrow what you were thankful for today? You know, that puts a whole new perspective on things. Now, God does not withhold things from us because we were not thankful for it yesterday. But just imagine if something you're not thankful for today, you don't get tomorrow. Your breath, your hearing, your eyesight, your ability to be able to walk, your family, your friends, you know, the ability to be able to worship him freely in this country. I mean, there's just so many things. So let us, as his children, always bring him thanksgiving from our hearts. For sometimes even the simplest things, you know, and to be able to just say, thank you, Lord. And he wants to hear it from his children, just like we would want to hear it from our children. Let me let you spend a moment in silent prayer. And you just thanking God for whatever might come to your heart and mind. You may have not said anything out loud, but just whatever comes to your mind today, just give him thanks. Let's pray. Father God, we could live a lifetime, Lord, but we could never have enough breath in our bodies to be able to say thank you for all the wonderful blessings that you have bestowed upon us. God, some of those blessings are very evident to us because for one thing, Lord, we prayed for it. And we saw it come into existence, Lord. We were able to be recipient of it. And God, we don't want to be ungrateful children. But God, instead, we want to be grateful children and make sure that we say thank you. But Lord, there's also times whenever we don't realize that, Father, you are blessing us. And God, we do want to just say thank you. Lord, whenever there's trials, Lord, whenever there's troubles, God, you told us that in all things give thanks. God, we don't necessarily thank you for the trials and those things, but Lord, in those times, we do want to say thank you. That Lord, that we serve an awesome God. That God, that we can come to you boldly because of your Son, Jesus Christ, allowing us to be able to do so through his shed blood. And Lord, through the moving of the Holy Spirit, Father, we can know that you are here with us. And that, Father, that no matter how big the trial, no matter what the troubles may be, God is not bigger than you. God, as this week, Lord, just been reminded so many times that, Father, that we need to tell those trials and troubles about not how big they are, but instead about how big our God is. And so, Lord, we just want to come to you, Father, first off, with just thanksgiving on our hearts. Lord, just knowing that you love us, you care for us, you're here with us. God, above all, you did make a way for us to have salvation. And Lord, this day, may that be proclaimed in this place, Father, and also willing to share it with others, Lord, of how good you've been to us, Lord, especially through your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand again if you are physically able. Let's sing, Lead Me to the Cross. Savior, I come to quiet my soul. Remember redemption's hill where your blood was spilled for my ransom. Oh, and everything I once held dear, I cast. I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me to the cross. You were as I tempted. Tried, human. The Word became flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen. Oh, in everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me. I belong to you. Lead me to the cross. Lead me to the cross. All I once held dear, built my life upon. All this world reveals and wars to own. All I once thought gained, I have counted loss. Spent in words now compared to this. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Now my heart's desire is to know you more, to be found in you and known as yours, to possess by faith what I could not earn, all surpassing gift of righteousness. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your sufferings, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you to live and never die. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
There are days when I wake up and my faith is cold and tired, and the light feels so dim. It's not like me just to give up, so I'm bringing you my dry bones, breathing me again. I need that wind to start blowing, I need these eyes to be open, I need my heart to keep hoping, so I'm calling out. I need a revival, feel you moving in my soul. Give me that fire I haven't felt in far too long. Holy Ghost, come awaken, bring me back to the days when wonder-working power was alive in me. I need a revival. jumped right off the page. A new beginning in a new life. Felt the joy of my salvation. Won't you take me there today? I need a revival. Feel your moving in my soul. Give me that fire, haven't felt in far too long. Holy Ghost, come awaken. Bring me back to the days when wonder working power was alive in me.
These eyes to be opened. I need my heart to keep hoping. So I'm calling now. I need that wind to start blowing. I need these eyes to be opened. I need my heart to keep hoping. So I'm calling now.
I need that wind to start blowing. I need these eyes to be opened. I need my heart to keep open, so I'm calling out. I need a revival, feel your moving in my soul. Give me that fire, haven't felt in far too long. Holy Ghost, come awaken, bring me back to the days when wonder-working power was alive in me.
Family, what a blessing, what a great song. Well, I invite you to take your Bibles with me back to 2 Peter one more time as we will conclude this particular book today of 2 Peter. We're going to look at the final two verses today, verses 17 and 18. And as we get ready to get into his word, into this sermon, let's bow for prayer one more time. Father God, we come now, Lord, to this moment. Lord, will we take your precious word, we open it up, we read it, and then, God, we want to see you through it. God, we want you to speak to our hearts so that, Father, that we can realize this is much more than just a book, but, God, it is you speaking to us. Father, in a day and time, whenever people don't think that you talk, you don't speak anymore, God, may they be reminded, Father, you're still very loud and clear. They just got to open up the book. Now, Father, I pray, Lord, that we would also open up our hearts, Lord, our minds, our ears, and, Lord, our eyes, so that, Father, that we might be able to receive truths from this, so that then, God, we might be able to go from here, first off saying, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. And then, Lord, also leave out of here perhaps differently. Lord, with a deeper understanding and a greater knowledge and having truth on our side. Father, that whenever we go out of here, we can say, Lord, it's been good to be in church today. Now, Father, I pray, Lord, that as I as your servant, Lord, as I stand before your people this day, that God, that you would use me as you see fit. Lord, you know my prayer. Move me out of the way, for you know I have nothing to say. But God, your Holy Spirit, speak through me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, one of the wonderful things about this book in which we have just read and just studied and you've heard these sermons on for these past months is that while Peter was writing these things, he was writing to a congregation, to a church, and to churches that were filled with people that still have some of the same struggles in which we have today. Now, yeah, we have a lot of first world problems that they didn't have to face. Like, they never had to face the internet being down. They never had to face, you know, church services with the sound system not working right or PowerPoint on a glitch. You know, those are all first world problems. But you know, whenever you boil away all of the stuff that we have deemed creature comforts nowadays, we all still, no matter who you are, no matter where you are, we all have a lot of the same struggles in which we face in our lives. One of those things in which we can have a struggle with is actually our understanding of who God is. Now, I want you to understand something about this, and that is that whenever we are in a life, we're living it, but we should never live it apart from God. Life is precious. God gave it to us. And God, in return, desires that we give our souls to Him in such a way that He might be able to save us, but also live with us in our daily life. So whenever trials and tribulations and temptations even come our way, we're able to move closer to Him because we know that beyond a shadow of a doubt, He's there with us. Peter was now an old man, old for his time. And Peter had been told by God that his time was coming to an end. And Peter then had a choice, and that is, well, I know that my end is near, so, you know, I've lived a pretty good life for the Lord, so now I'm going to live it up for me. I've known people who have done that, who have said, you know what, I was forced to go to church when I was a kid, and I married a religious woman, and so we had to go to church, but you know what, I'm now an old man, you know, and I'm just, I don't want to do that no more. Well, it's because they had religion, but they never had Jesus. I've also known people who are coming to a stage in their life where maybe things did not turn out as just as they had planned. And they blame God for it in such a way like, okay, God, if that's the way you want to be, if that's what you're going to do, then I'm through, I'm done, and they walk away from it. Personally, I feel like those who would choose to do that never were really with God to begin with. Now, another thing is that Peter could look and say, you know what, God, I'm old. You've given me these signs that my life is almost over with. I want to go out of here with a bang. I want to go out of here serving you, loving you, and still teaching others about you. That's why we got 2 Peter. And so understand that whenever Peter was writing this, he was writing it all for the glory of God in this particular time in his life so that God could be glorified in this particular season of his life. And then he also comes to this place where he's writing these people who are actually these new Christians, new followers of Christ, that are being heavily persecuted for their faith. They're being persecuted by the government because they're now followers of Christ. They're being persecuted by their old church because they're now followers of Christ. They're being, when I say that, many of these used to be Jews and now they're followers of Christ, and there were these Judaizers that were saying, okay, you know, you can believe in Christ, but you still got to follow all of these laws of us Jews. And Christ came to fulfill the law. And so they're having struggles there, but also they were having a lot of struggles even with their own families. Because inside of the family unit, some would become followers of Christ and some would want to hang on to their Judaism. And then others just, you know, they were just there. We all got ones like that in our family, don't we? But Peter instead says, you know, says, I'm going to send this out to give encouragement and instruction to those people who are living during such a time as this. And let me tell you, folks, what Peter was writing to, those problems they were having, a lot of those same problems we're still having today. But you see, we get so caught up in all of our first world problems that we fail to see the spiritual problems that might be around us as well. You know, if your power goes out, you know, call Duke Energy. If your water quits, you know, call Greenville Water. If your internet goes down, you know, you call Charter, Spectrum, or whoever your internet service with. If your cell phone quits working, you know who to call. When life as what you had expected it quits, who do you call? You better know it's God. And by the way, if you're looking for his phone number, it's in the white pages in your Bible. And we're going to look today at these passages of scriptures. The last two verses, there's a negative and there's a positive. But when you got a good battery, you got a negative and a positive that completes the circuit. And so we read in verse 17 and 18, he says, "You already know these things, dear friends, so be on guard. Then you will not be carried away by the errors of those wicked people and lose your own secure footing. Rather, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All glory to him, both now and forever. Amen." Now, let's take this passage of scripture apart. I'm just going to try to do a homily with you this morning. And that is, he says, you. He's speaking to us who are fellow followers of Christ. He's speaking to us, the church. He's speaking to those of us who have publicly professed that we have a faith in God and a forgiveness of our sin through the Savior Jesus Christ and have desired to want to know him and be used of him. So he says, already you know these things. You already know it. You know, whenever you're maybe teaching a child and maybe you're going through some things, you realize that one of the best ways to teach somebody is through repetition, right? Sometimes the best way that you learn is through repetition. You know, if you've ever taken music, you know, the teacher will give you the simple little chords or notes to play, and you just keep playing them until where even the neighbors are wanting you to quit playing those little notes, you know? But from that foundation, though, comes everything else, but it's through that repetition. Well, what do we already know? Let's just look. In chapter 1 of this, we get the greeting from Peter, but then he's telling us, grow in your faith. And we looked about how important it is that we know we should grow in our faith. And then he also tells us one of the ways to do that, and it's a key way, is to pay attention to the scriptures, verses 12 through 21 of chapter 1. Pay attention to the scriptures. God has given us his precious book. It is complete. There's nothing else that needs to be added to it. In fact, if we add to it or take away from it, we're looking for judgment from God. But then he also tells us that he gives us the warnings about false teachers. Because see, if we're not careful in knowing the scriptures, we're going to fall for the schemes and the wiles of that of false teachers that easily want to betray us. And then we also learned in chapter 3 that we are living in the last days. For the day of the Lord is coming. And so we have been examining these things, and yet what Peter is really teaching them, he's not really truly told them much anything that they did not already know. Now I got a question for you. He said you should know these things. I got a question for you. Do not answer out loud. I'm just giving you a rhetorical question to think about. What do you know? What do you know? Now, some know more than others. But yet what we must understand is that you can know a lot of things about a lot of different things, but there are some very basic things that if you don't know, you miss the whole boat. For instance, you already know there is a God, do you not? K Okay? And then we also know that God so loved us so much that he was willing to give us his only begotten son. You know that, don't you? That if we should believe in him, we would not perish, but instead we will have everlasting life. You know that, don't you? If you don't, then this is where you need to start with your knowledge about God, is make sure that you have the foundation of who God is and who Jesus is and who the Holy Spirit is, and the importance of God's word, and the importance of worshiping him, and the importance of church. And we look at those things, and we should never treat them as like, well, yeah, I got that. But from that base is all other knowledge built. Now, let me help you to understand something. It's actually from those things all other wisdom is given. Because let me tell you, I would rather have wisdom than over knowledge any day of the week. I mean, many of us here today, we have been blessed with education beyond our own means. Some of us have multiple college degrees. And yet, I have personally known some of the most intelligent people that were also some of the most unwisest people I've ever met in my life. Because in their intellect, they never gained the wisdom of who God is, who Jesus is, who the Holy Spirit is, the insignificance of worship, the Bible, prayer, and the basics of biblical discipleship. So folks, that's why I tell you that, you know, we want to be firmly planted on who God is. And Peter's just saying, I want you to know these things, dear friends. Over these last months, you've seen these three objects up here on the pulpit. One is a square. And we've said, we want to make sure that we're square with God. Because, you know, if we're not square with God, then the rest of our life is going to be leaning pretty heavily. You know, it's not going to be right. We also said we wanted to be plumb with his word, to where we're not going to take the word and slant it to make it say something that we wished it would say, or slant it in such a way that we want to then be able to justify our actions and even our sins. We want to be plumb with God's word. And that's also reminding us to be plumb with Jesus, because Jesus is the word. And then you see the level over there. And that is, we want to be level with God's children. We want to be level with each other. You see, if we're not square with God, we're not plumb with his word, we're going to be a half a bubble off with our fellow man. Are we not? Yeah. And so one of the truths in which he's saying from this is he's saying, I want you to already know these things, dear friends. You already know these things. But why? And he tells us so that we can be on guard. You can be on guard, then you will carry away, so that you will not be carried away by the errors of those wicked people and lose your own secure footing. Be on guard. Some of us have been in the military, and we know what it means to pull guard duty. Some of us worked in prisons and jails, and you know what it means to be a guard. And if you're a mama, you know what it means to be on guard. I mean, you know, I'm not saying daddies aren't good guards. We are in our own way. But the mamas, though, they just got that just built into them. And I believe it's because God designed us that the man would go out and he would hunt and provide for his family and bring it back to his family. But the mama, though, was the one that was taking care of the home front and the little children. You know, you don't mess with a mama with cubs, do you? I have known people that it would have been better for you to go out and pick a fight with a full-grown black bear that has cubs than to mess with somebody that's got little children. Can I get a witness in this, ladies? Yeah. I mean, you know, as the old saying goes, you know, mess with me, and you might hurt my feelings. Mess with my family, and I'm going to hurt you and your feelings. And while a man might think about it, a woman's already clawing your eyes out over it, you know? Personally, I'd much rather see two men fight than two women, because men fight at least halfway fair. Women do not fight fair. Some of you are like, oh yeah, yeah, bring it on, you know. Never seen so much chaos. I mean, it's like two cats, hair flying everywhere. Nonetheless, though, I don't know why these images are coming to my mind right now, but I'm just saying, though, as protective as what you would be from someone or something getting into your home to cause your children problems and danger and sickness, then let's not also forget about being on guard about the spiritual things that can get into our lives and get into our homes, that can do damage to our children and your grandchildren. Well, I just picked a heart chord right there, didn't I? I heard this last week. Hurt me and I'll turn the other cheek. Hurt my wife and I'll smack your cheek. Mess with my kids and I'll smack both of your cheeks. Mess with my grandchildren, I'll bury your cheeks. I got a thumbs up. Can I get an amen on something like that? You know, and nonetheless, though, you know what I'm talking about. But while we would want to protect them in such a way, we have to know that we've got to be on guard against all this stuff that's trying to bombard our families and our little children. And the way in which a guard is able to guard is that they are attentive to their surroundings. You know, you don't fall asleep whenever you're on guard duty. If you do, there is severe punishment to be paid. I had a friend of mine that was in Vietnam who told about how that they drove up to the base one day, and there was a Vietnamese colonel that was on the bus that was going into the base, and one of his soldiers was there at the front gate, and the bus driver stopped. He waited, and they realized that the guard was asleep. The Vietnamese colonel got off the bus, went over there, and shot the guy and killed him for being asleep on guard. But also, what I know what it's like. You close your eyes, you're kind of asleep, and then all of a sudden the boss, the TI shows up, and you know they're there. So you very quickly say, in Jesus' name I pray, amen. So what I'm saying, though, is first off, be awake, be alert. And then another thing is that whenever the enemy comes, you should then be able to know what to do. Because see, if you're going to be trained as being a guard, it's not just for you to stand there and look pretty. You should be able to know what to do whenever the enemy comes. Did you hear what I said? When, not if, the enemy comes. Be able to be trained in knowing what to do. Now, there's different things to do, but let me tell you, though, in the spiritual realm, whenever you're on guard, you see the enemy coming, you know how to combat the enemy. You should be able to already know how to pray. You should already have God's word hid in your heart that you may not sin against God. You should be able to know the church and the koinonia fellowship in which we experience. We can call on one another. We should be able to know what to do when it comes to us because we've already been practicing it. Now, that guard is there to protect, but the guard is also there to warn. You know, they always told us that when we were having to pull fire guard, the first thing you do before you even start trying to fight the fire is that you warn everybody else there is a fire, and you can do both of them pretty much at the same time. Who will you warn? Let it begin with your family. Let it begin with your closest friends, and let it begin with Berea and beyond. And this is also one of the reasons why we're having this evangelism conference coming up in a few weeks. Because in evangelism, we're actually helping to warn other people of the outcome if they don't know Christ. And so he's telling us that they will not be carried away by the errors of the wicked people and lose their own secure footing. And so we do these things so that we might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, the schemes of the devil. For you men that are part of this, Ephesians, my daily text message with the scriptures in it, we're into that part about the spiritual armor of God right now. And so this is why we do these things. But you know, one of the main things we must do as a Christian is to be able to look back and know what it is in which we need to do. In verse 14 he says, "And so, dear friends, while you're waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that are pure and blameless in his sight." There's two things that we need to make sure that we are always applying in our lives, and that is, number one is that we are teachable. You ever met anybody that's just not teachable? If I had to describe a person that is not teachable, I would describe them kind of as being a know-it-all. Don't you just enjoy being around people who know it all? Aren't they just always so much fun to be with? But also, they're somewhat arrogant. They're arrogant in they can never be wrong because they've already reached a grand spot of just, I know it all. But for us, we need to be teachable. And that's why we still come to life group. That's why we still come to church on Sunday. That's why we still have daily devotions, so that we might be able to stay teachable. So listen, stay teachable. But be teachable about, and the second thing is about the truth. You see, the truth is what's going to set us free. The truth is what will guard our hearts. The truth is Jesus Christ. So see, whenever we stay teachable in the truth, then we become the guard that God wants us to be, securing our own footing and also protecting those who are around us. But if you're not teachable, where you see no need for church, you see no need for Bible, you see no reason for any of these other things, and you're pretty much saying, oh, I've already done it all. In my study this week, you know, it's kind of like you think about ones like Moses, who had that burning bush experience, who heard the voice of God, but yet Moses kept pressing on to see God's glory even after that one experience. You take like Paul, for instance, very, very educated man, but yet he continued to study and to educate himself in the knowledge of Christ. Charles Ryrie said, "In this life we never ascend to a plateau above and beyond which there is no further ground to gain." There's always something more to learn. And he says, rather, and here's what I want you to learn about. Be teachable, stay in the truth, but look at verse 18. "Rather, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." Grow in the knowledge of grace and of knowledge. Now, let me take these two real quickly for you. And look, and you could, in first reading, it says, rather you must grow, mean develop, in order to get stronger. And the stronger you are, the more productive you can be and the more useful you can be for the kingdom of God. You know, it's beginning springtime. It'll soon be summer. Some of you have already got your summer vacations to the beach already planned. More power to you. I'm a once every 5 years kind of beach guy. Unless you're paying, and I'll go if you're paying, you know. But I saw all the sand I wanted to see for a lifetime being deployed to the Middle East enough times. But let me just tell you a little story about sharks. Did you know that if you take a baby shark, baby shark, doo-doo, 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 baby, I'm just making sure y'all are awake. I'm keeping y'all hearing everything. All right. If you take a baby shark that is only about 3 to 6 inches long, and you put him into an aquarium, do you realize that that shark will mature fully but never grow beyond about 6 inches? Everything will mature, but it'll only be about 6 inches. You take that same baby shark and you throw him into the vastness of the ocean, and he could grow to be a big old whopper. I mean, you know, we hear about these fishermen catching 300, 400, 500 pound great white sharks, you know. Environment allowed him to be able to grow. As where if he's only inside that little aquarium, he'll mature, but he'll never grow. That's why I tell you, don't put God inside of a box, because if you do, then you're really stunting your own growth, because you'll never grow beyond the faith of what you have already determined about God. But instead, get into the vastness of God's grace and into knowledge and watch yourself grow. You know, to the person who has never come to church, to the person who's never read their Bible, but yet to the person who starts coming to church and start listening to the word being taught and being preached and being sung, you know, and then you put them with some other Christians that can speak a word of truth into them and help them to be able to understand the scriptures and how to pray. And then you take that person and you show them the importance of daily in the word and in prayer. And that person just begins to grow. And they become so much more than what they were whenever they never had that kind of walk with Christ before. And so we see these words, grace and knowledge. You can look at it as growing in grace, but let me tell you this. Grace and knowledge are kind of the same thing. But understand this. You can't not really grow in grace without gaining knowledge, and you can't really gain knowledge in God without growing in grace. Let me give you a perfect example of this, because I realize what time it is. It's like peanut butter and jelly. You know, you got peanut butter and you got jelly, but you mix them together, first thing, you can never separate them, can you? Once you mix them two delicious items together, there is no unseparating them. And together, they just make just a really good sandwich, do they not? My little grandson, Miles, that's one of his favorite meals. I've even taught him, it's peanut butter and jelly time. You know? And so, you know, the grace and the knowledge, while they're two different things, they're really going to be mixed together. And whenever they're mixed together like that, it is so good. It's better than what you could ever imagine. And so this is what Peter is coming. He says, you must grow, but don't grow on the junk food of the world. Instead, grow in the meat and the milk of Jesus Christ and feast on his word and this grace and this knowledge, not just of, yeah, I got grace, you know, yeah, I've got some knowledge, but instead it's of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, while you can spend an enormous amount of time in studying just about who Jesus is, I want you to know him, not just know about him. Because I even know atheists that have written books about Jesus Christ, but they don't know him. I don't want you just to say, yeah, I've heard about him. I want you to experience him. I want you to know him. And from this, whenever we know him as our Lord and Savior, notice here again, we talked about Lord and Savior, Lord and Savior. We say that a lot. Have you accepted Christ as being your Lord and Savior? Here again, you really don't get one without the other. The Lord means that you've made him the master of your life. You realize that it's no longer you that lives, but instead it is now Christ who now lives in me. You realize that whenever he is Lord, that means that you don't own anything, not even your own life, but instead you are now being given the responsibility of being a steward of all of this stuff so that then the master, Jesus, might be able to use it through us. That's being Lord and Savior. Savior means that we can have eternal hope and security in knowing that whenever this life is over with, we know where we're going and how we're getting there. So we keep learning about this Lord and Savior. And so all of this is being done for this one thing. All glory to him. All glory to him. Both now and forever. Amen. So be it. If you want to bring glory to God, make sure you're square with God, plumb with his word, and level with his people. Make sure of those things. And as Peter got through writing these words and he signed off, amen, and he sent it out. I don't know how much longer he lived. But I know he went out of here still being teachable and staying in the truth. And today I'm asking you, are you teachable? Are you staying in the truth? Are you bringing God glory in all of these things? It all begins with you knowing Jesus, not just about him. And if you want to know Jesus, we want to introduce you to him today. It's something we call salvation. You come. Let me explain it to you. Let me tell you the good news about how that he can forgive you and how he will accept you into his family. And so as we stand together and Michael comes and leads us in this song, understand that these things are for his glory. What you will right now do with Jesus is going to determine your glory to him. You come. This altar is open. You can pray where you are. Talk to me before you leave this day. Let's stand together. You to repeat those words from your heart. We're not going to sing it. We're going to read it. Read it with me. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all. You're the best. You're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Let's sing this one more time. You come if God's speaking to your heart.
Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater.
joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord.
Thank you so much for being here today. And as we get ready to go, just once again, I want you just to grow in the Lord in any way that you that you possibly can. And if we as a church, I as your pastor, can help you, don't hesitate in reaching out to me. And I know that I said a while ago about the men and their daily text Monday through Friday of the scripture and everything. If any man, if you want to join in on that text, just let me know, and I'll be glad to add you to the list. I got about 36 guys going through right now. We're about to finish up the book of Ephesians, and we're going to be starting a new book real soon. So if you want in on that, let me know. And so as we get ready to go out of here, don't forget, if you want to go to the evangelism conference, give me your sheet or drop it in the offering plate and everything. And let's go out of here with a word on our mouths. What is that word? Maranatha. Yes. What does it mean? Jesus is coming. Yeah, let's go out of here with our benediction today. It says, may God give you more and more grace and peace as you grow in your knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.